Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Apocalypse Z, Book 4, by Baileigh Higgins, narrated by Kristin James. Chapter 1. Amy. Amy's eyes snapped open when a hand clamped shut over her mouth. In the dim light of her room, she could barely make out the shape of her attacker. All she could see was a hulking shadow bent over her bed, its figure silhouetted against the moonlit curtains. She lashed out with her hands and feet, hampered by the heavy folds of her winter blankets. Her voice came out as a muffled cry, and the smell of the stranger's skin was sharp in her nostrils. Panic shot through her veins, and the only person she could think of was her brother.
"Alex, help!"
Seconds later, Amy froze when the cold steel of a gun barrel pressed against her temple. In a low voice, her attacker said, "Stop moving or I'll shoot." She could tell it was a man, but couldn't place his identity. He was a stranger, and somehow that made everything worse. It was the middle of the night, and a strange man held a gun to her head while she lay in bed. She'd never felt so vulnerable in her life. Dressed in PJs with her shotgun 3 feet away, she was defenseless. The barrel dug into her skin, and the man said, "Don't say a word. Not a peep out of you, or your brains will be scattered all over this room. Got that?" His voice was cold, and Amy believed every word he said. With wide eyes, she nodded.
"Just do whatever he wants for now."
Suddenly, the hand across her lips was gone, and she sucked in a deep breath. Despite her overwhelming desire to scream, she kept quiet. The man chuckled.
"That's a good girl. Now get up and walk downstairs to the living room. We're having a meeting tonight, and you're invited."
On shaky legs, Amy climbed out of bed and shoved her feet into the waiting slippers. On autopilot, she crossed the room and walked toward the stairs. Her attacker followed, a menacing danger. A shiver ran down her spine at the thought that he could shoot her at any moment. The house was dark and silent, but a faint glow emitted from downstairs. She made her way toward it, and the light grew brighter. On the kitchen counter, a lamp shined, and another burned on the dining room table. A couple of candles lit the rest of the area, though dark hollows remained in the corners. A group of people stood in the center of the living room, and Amy spotted both Tara and Alex in an instant. It took all of her self-control not to cry out with horror, but she remembered the stranger's threat. With her lips pressed together, she halted a few feet away from them and waited. Alex was on his knees on the carpet, his hands placed behind his head. Tara was next to him, but on her feet, arms folded around her chest. Both looked shocked and bewildered, much like Amy felt. The rest were strangers, except for Dr. Bannock, whom she recognized in an instant. She'd only seen him once on the day he let free the zombies in the lab. It had been a brief moment, but enough to brand his aging, bespectacled face into her memory for life. A tall man with pale eyes addressed her kidnapper.
"Is she the last one, Red?"
The man behind her grunted.
"She's the last, Lieutenant. I didn't see anyone else."
Amy's eyes flew to the lieutenant, her mind buzzing.
"King, it must be King and Bannock. What do they want? Revenge?"
Both the lieutenant and doctor were dressed in ordinary clothes, and a glance at Red confirmed his plain garb as well. They were rough and unshaven, their bodies rail thin. Apparently, life outside the base was a lot harder than on the inside. The others were dressed in fatigues, their hair cut short, and their jaws as smooth as a baby's behind. Soldiers, all three of them. It seemed that despite his disgrace, The former Lieutenant King still had friends inside the fort. That explained how he got inside and how he made it across the grounds without getting caught. Amy glared at the soldiers, anger boiling in her chest.
They're supposed to protect us, not betray us. Cowards.
King frowned at Red's answer and turned toward one of the soldiers.
Damn it, Perez, where are the rest? You said they'd all be here.
Perez shook his head. I'm sorry, sir. I thought for sure they'd be together. It's New Year's Eve, after all.
So what happened?
King asked. When no one answered, he leveled his gun at Alex.
Where are the rest of you?
Alex stared at King, his lips pressed together.
Screw you.
King sighed.
Let's try again, shall we?
He turned the gun on Amy, and Alex's eyes widened.
No, don't hurt her. Answer my question, or I'll kill her right now,
King said, his expression as smooth as marble.
If you hurt my sister, I swear to God. Enough with the insults. They're pointless,
King interrupted.
Either you tell me what I want to know, or she's dead.
Alex stared at Amy with a helpless look on his face.
Alex, don't tell him! They're our friends!
Amy cried, but she knew it was futile. He'd do anything for her. It was both his greatest strength and his greatest weakness.
Saul and Dylan are helping Nick to keep the peace tonight. They're patrolling the perimeter and doing spot checks in the barracks,
Alex said, his shoulders sagging with defeat.
Why?
King asked.
Nick's in charge, isn't he? Why's he doing the dirty work? Nick's not like that. He's a hands-on leader,
Alex replied with reluctance.
And we can't afford to let zombies breach the walls because a couple of soldiers decided to get drunk and abandon their posts. Then why aren't you out there as well? I'm due for a dawn patrol. What about the doctor,
Ethan Hayes? King asked.
Ethan is at the infirmary. We rarely see him anymore since Dylan and Nick got together. What a shit show,
Lieutenant King said, pacing back and forth.
I guess I should have seen this coming. Instead, I relied on intel from a bunch of morons.
Directing an angry look at Perez and the other two soldiers, he continued.
I suppose my revenge will have to wait. We've got Dr. Lee. That's the important thing.
What do you want from me?
Tara asked, her voice thin but steady.
I want you to work for me, Dr. Lee. I want you to manufacture the cure for my men, and eventually, the vaccine.
King's eyes scanned her face.
You will be looked after, and you need not fear being harassed.
Forget it, King, Tara replied, her hands curling into fists. I'm not going anywhere.
I'm afraid you don't have a choice, Doctor. You're coming with us,
King said. He waved at Perez.
Tie her up.
Yes, sir.
Perez used a cable tie to secure Tara's hands behind her back. Her feeble struggles were no match for his brute strength. Amy wanted to protest, but one look at Red's face and the way his gun pointed at her back convinced her otherwise. She pressed her lips together while trying to think of a way to escape. The entire time, Dr. Bannock watched from a shadowy corner, his sweaty hands wringing together in a display of nervousness. His eyes blinked behind his thick spectacle lenses, and his thinning hair did little to disguise his shiny scalp.
Dr. Bannock, Tara cried, aren't you going to do something? This is crazy. You can't just run around kidnapping people.
Dr. Bannock shrugged.
Why not? It's a new world out there, Dr. Lee, and Lieutenant King has promised to look after me.
He's lying. He only cares about himself.
Dr. Bannock smiled.
Great minds think alike.
Tara whirled toward King.
Why take me? Why not my research? You've got a scientist already. Take what you want and leave us alone.
It's not that simple, Dr. Lee. Dr. Bannock has assured me of his usefulness in that regard, but apparently it will take some time for him to interpret your work, King said. Time I do not have since I've been forced to flee the fort. Without a secure base, I need that cure, or my men don't stand a chance.
I can't believe you're doing this, Tara muttered, an angry flush staining her cheeks.
Believe it, Dr. Lee, Bannock replied. Soon we'll be working together again, just like old times.
Screw you, Bannock, Tara said.
What about the rest of them? Perez asked. We can search the base. I'm sure we'll find them. There are only so many places they could be.
It's too risky, King said. I would have liked to grab the doctor. I could use a surgeon, but it will have to wait for now.
But sir!
No, Perez. We can't afford to get caught. We're leaving, and that's final, King replied. Besides, there will be other opportunities. This isn't the last Fort Detrick will see of me. And these two? Red said, nudging Amy and nodding toward Alex. Kill them, King commanded. We don't need either of the two.
No! Alex shouted, surging to his feet. He charged at the nearest soldier, but stopped mid-stride when a shot rang out. Red bloomed on his white t-shirt, and he stared at the spot with a disbelieving gaze.
Alex!
Amy screamed, her voice taut with horror and pain. She tried to run to him, but Red grabbed her by the arm and held her back. His grip was rough, and the gun barrel he jabbed into her spine held the promise of death. She didn't care. All she cared about was her brother. Their eyes locked across the room, and time slowed to a trickle. Amy remembered all the years they'd spent together as a family, years that had bonded them as brother and sister. The fights, the laughter, the tears, and the sorrow. It was all there. A glittering tapestry of love and loss ripped away by a single bullet.
I'm sorry.
Alex blinked once, and his lips formed the words, I love you, sis. Slowly, he toppled over to lie face down on the carpet. A growing pool of blood spread around his body, thick and viscous. Voices buzzed around Amy's head, but she couldn't make out the words. None of it mattered, not even the thought of dying. She closed her eyes, preparing herself for the shot that would end her life. It never came. Instead, Tara threw herself at King and pleaded with him.
Please don't kill her. She's just a child. She's 16 years old, for heaven's sake.
King shrugged. Her age doesn't exempt her from death. The apocalypse should have taught you that by now, Doctor.
I'm begging you, please, spare her. If you do, I promise I'll do anything you want, Tara said, her cheeks wet with tears.
King's gaze grew calculating.
Do you swear it? You'll work for me without complaint and without trying to escape if I spare her life.
Tara nodded, her hands twisting behind her back, already swollen from her bonds.
I swear it.
King nodded.
It's a deal. Red, tie the girl's hands. She's coming with us.
Yes, sir, Red replied.
Leave her here, Tara said. I swore, didn't I?
Maybe, but I'd feel better if she comes with us to ensure your obedience, King said.
Tara shook her head, and she looked at Amy.
I'm sorry. I tried.
Amy nodded. It's okay. With rough hands, Red yanked Amy's arms behind her back and secured her wrists together with a plastic cable tie. The sharp edges cut into her skin, but she hardly noticed. Her eyes went back to Alex, searching for signs of life. Any sign at all.
King followed her gaze and said,
Perez, make sure he's dead. I don't want to leave behind unfinished business. It'll only give the girls something to yearn for.
Yes, sir, Perez answered, raising his gun.
No!
Amy screamed, struggling against Red's hold, as Perez pumped three more bullets into Alex's back.
No, 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 no!
Alex jerked with each successive shot, and the pool of crimson blood beneath him spread ever further. He made no sound, and at that moment, Amy realized he was dead. She squeezed her eyes shut and fought against the pain that threatened to overwhelm her. It was no use. Sorrow burned through her veins like acid, and she found herself unable to think or even move of her own volition. King continued to shout out orders, and the soldiers stripped the house of all its supplies. They even emptied Tara and Amy's cupboards, stuffing their belongings into duffel bags along with the available food, water, and weapons. Once they were finished, Red forced Amy outside, where a van awaited them. Light snow crunched beneath her slippers, and she shivered in her thin pajamas. The moon shone down with a cold eye, distant and uncaring. Amy considered screaming, but what was the use? There was no one to hear her, no one to help. Her brother was dead, and the rest of her friends scattered around the base. She was alone, except for Tara. At the entrance to the van, Red taped her mouth shut with duct tape and tossed her into the back. She rolled across the cold metal floor, wincing when she hit her head on the side. Tara was thrown in with as little ceremony, and together they helped each other up into a sitting position. The supplies from the house followed them into the van, and Amy nearly cried with relief when Perez tossed them a couple of blankets. Huddled inside the warm folds, they could do nothing but wait as fate and a group of criminals tore them away from their home and loved ones. Leaning against Tara's warm body, Amy stared into the darkness, her heart as hollow as a drum. The love and affection it once held was gone, replaced by anger, bitterness, and sorrow. With her teeth clenched together, she made a vow.
I swear on my life that King and his men will pay. One day, I'll kill them all.
Chapter 2. Tara. Tara stared out of the back of the van as they pulled away with King behind the wheel. Perez and Bannock sat next to him, while Red and the other two soldiers followed in a second vehicle. She was still stunned after the brutal killing of Alex, an act so cold and final she couldn't make sense of it. Next to her, Amy sat silently, and Tara could only imagine how she felt. Tara knew, however, that she couldn't allow grief to cloud her mind. She couldn't let King and his men take them away from the base to an unknown location. Once that happened, their chances of rescue shrank to almost zero. Think, Tara, think. First, she needed to get rid of the duct tape across their lips. That way, they could call for help if the opportunity presented itself. Mumbling at Amy, she tried to indicate her thoughts, pointing with her shoulder to her mouth. With a frown of concentration, Amy sat upright and tried to interpret the motions. Finally, her eyes widened and she nodded. With awkward movements, she turned around and wiggled her bound fingers at Tara. Tara lowered her head until Amy was able to grip the edges of the duct tape. With a yank of Tara's head, the sticky tape came free.
Oh, that's better. You're next, Amy.
Once they were both freed from their gags, Tara said,
Right, we need to get these cable ties off. I'll look around while you sit tight.
Okay,
Amy replied in a small voice. Tara's heart twisted in her chest.
It'll be all right, Amy. I promise.
My brother.
A couple of tears wound their way down Amy's cheeks.
I know, but he might still be alive.
You think so?
Amy's tone held a thread of desperate hope. Tara hesitated. In truth, she didn't think Alex had survived the attack, but she couldn't admit that to Amy. He's young and strong. Anything is possible. Amy's expression fell. Even she could hear the lie in Tara's voice.
I don't think so, but thanks anyway.
I'm sorry, Amy. I really am. But we have to get out of here. We can't do anything for Alex or our friends while we're stuck with these assholes.
I understand.
You keep watch while I search for a way out.
She cast around the supplies for something to cut their bonds. Anything with a sharp edge. It was difficult, shuffling around on her knees with her hands tied behind her back. The van shuddered and slid from side to side as it drove across the rough, snowy grounds of the base. The driver, King, paid scant regard to the speed limit or the terrain. Several times she toppled over and had to fight her way upright again. She nudged through bottles of water, canned food, packets of noodles, and instant soup. None of it gave her what she needed. Finally, she shuffled toward the door and tried to open it. It wouldn't budge beneath her hands. Locked. Even the windows had been welded shut. There was no escape. Damn it!
Nothing?
Amy asked. Tara sighed and moved back to Amy's side.
I'm sorry, but no. Still, that doesn't mean we should give up. Anything can happen.
Amy nodded, the blanket pooled across her body. In the faint moonlight, the drying tears on her cheeks looked like silver paint. Tara shifted closer to the girl, offering what warmth and comfort she could. Suddenly, the van slowed to a stop, and Tara straightened up. Her heart banged in her chest as she wondered what was next. Somebody shouted to them, and a bobbing flashlight appeared next to the vehicle. Craning her neck, she spotted a sign and a stretch of fence. Realization flashed through her mind. They'd reached the gate, and the soldiers on guard had stopped the van. Behind them, Red and the others drew to a stop as well. Hope surged through her body, and she threw herself at the window, screaming, "Help! Help us!" With all her might, she banged against the glass with her shoulder, screaming nonstop. Amy added her cries to Tara's, and together they created as much noise as possible. The dim figure outside turned toward them, and the flashlight shone directly at their faces. Tara grinned at Amy. "They heard us. We're saved." But her smile faltered when the soldier slammed his fist on the window next to her face.
"Shut your mouth, would you?"
"What?" Tara cried, unable to comprehend. "What are you saying? Why aren't you helping us?"
"Keep quiet."
"Please," Tara begged. "We've been kidnapped and—"
"I said shut it," the soldier growled with a final slam of his hand on the glass.
"What's going on?"
Amy asked, her face pale in the spotlights that shone from above.
"I don't know," Tara said.
She stared at his receding figure with disbelief and watched as he was joined by two more. They talked to King for several moments, and one even had the gall to laugh and point at the girls in the van.
Amy gasped. "They're supposed to be on our side."
Tara could hear that tears weren't far from the surface. While Amy was a tough girl, Alex's death had taken its toll.
"Don't worry, Amy. I'll get us out of this. I promise."
Amy nodded, but didn't reply. Instead, she huddled deeper into her blanket until only her eyes showed. Tara turned back to the soldiers, hot rage running through her veins.
"You traitors!" she screamed. "Dirty scumbags!"
They continued to ignore her as the soldiers returned to their posts. All except King, who walked back to the driver's side. He paused and cast her a baleful look through the dirty window.
"You're wasting your time. Nobody is going to help you. They're on my payroll."
"You asshole!"
"Scream all you like, Doctor. Where we're going, nobody will hear or care. Except for the zombies.
He graced her with a faint smile before sliding behind the wheel and slamming the door shut. With a roar of the engine, he started the van and pulled away. The soldiers he left behind stared at the vehicle, their expressions remote. King was right. Nobody would lift a finger to help them. With a sigh of despair, Tara sank back next to Amy. The fiery anger of moments before leached away until she was left cold and shivering. She huddled beneath the blanket, desperate for warmth. The base retreated into the distance until it was lost in the darkness. Their home, everything and everyone they loved, gone with the snap of a finger. Her mind whirled as she tried to think of a plan, but nothing jumped out at her. Instead, the minutes passed as King took them further and further away from Fort Detrick.
Saul is going to be so worried. Dylan, Nick, even Ethan. What are we going to do?
Amy asked.
I don't know, sweetie. I don't know.
We have to do something, Amy persisted. We can't give up.
She began to wiggle back and forth while Tara watched with a sense of confusion.
What are you up to now?
You'll see.
Before long, Amy had worked her bound hands over her buttocks before pulling her knees close to her chest. With a final grunt of exertion, she tucked her feet through the loop formed by her arms and smiled. Her tied hands were now in the front.
Your turn.
Tara snorted.
I haven't tried that move since I was a kid. I'll probably rupture my spleen.
Amy shrugged.
It's worth a try.
Tara bit on her lower lip. Here goes. It took her a bit longer than it had taken Amy to complete the maneuver, but at last, her bound hands were at the front of her waist. She wiggled her fingers back and forth to restore the blood flow, wincing when they prickled. Amy, in the meantime, had copied Tara's actions from earlier and searched through the supplies for anything useful. She rummaged through the stuff King and his men had taken from their cupboards and produced a small black kit.
Yes! Amy cried, waving around the little bag.
What's that?
Tara asked.
It's my sewing kit.
Without explaining further, Amy unzipped the bag and produced a pair of tiny scissors. Tara held out her hands.
Amy, you're a genius.
Amy flashed her a smug smile as she sawed at the thick plastic that held Tara prisoner. The small scissors weren't very sharp, and it took several minutes to cut through the cable tie. At last, Tara was free, and it was Amy's turn to sit with her hands extended, her knees braced against the rocking of the van. Tara hacked at the girl's bonds, frustrated by the length of time it took. Every moment took them further and further away from home and made escape that much more difficult. With a small cry of triumph, Tara severed the final piece of plastic and the tie dropped away. Amy massaged her swollen wrists and fingers.
What's next?
We have to get out of this van, Tara said. Then we have to make our way back to the fort.
But we don't even know where we are, Amy protested.
Tara sank back on her heels, thinking it through. If King wanted her to continue her research, his base had to contain a lab with a biosafety level of 4, or at the very least, level 3. At the same time, he'd spoken of returning to Fort Detrick in the near future. That meant his new base had to be within a reasonable striking distance. Add in the fact that it had to be secure against the zombies, and the options became limited. There weren't any level 4 labs nearby that she knew of, but there were several level 3s. Among them were a number of university campuses, research facilities, and colleges. Her shoulders sagged when she realized it'd be impossible for her to guess. Still, they couldn't give up. Not yet. Tara pressed her face to the glass, desperate for any information on where King was taking them. She waved at Amy.
Look for a sign, anything that will give us a clue about where we're going.
Okay,
Amy said, scrambling to the other side. Minutes passed in silence as they scrutinized their surroundings. It was difficult to see in the dark with only the bouncing headlights of the two vehicles to light the way. They flashed across the monotonous gray countryside until it all blended into one featureless landscape. After a while, however, Tara's eyes adjusted, and she was able to make out more specific details. For the most part, they drove through deserted country lanes dotted with small towns. They passed a few wooded areas, a couple of farms, and a golf course at one point. There weren't many zombies around. The cold seemed to drive them into hiding, but they were there. When least expected, a monstrous face would jump out of the darkness and smash into the van, growling with hunger and rage. After the last such an incident caused her to jump with fright, Tara sat back with a sigh.
Anything?
No, I can't see much, Amy replied.
Suddenly, she gasped. Wait, there's a board!
Where?
Tara scrambled over, but she missed the sign by a millisecond. It flashed past her face before she could read what it said.
Damn it!
I saw a bit of it, Amy said, grabbing Tara's hand.
What did you see?
It said George something followed by Manassas, Amy replied. Does that mean anything to you?
Tara grinned as excitement fizzed through her veins. Yes, it does. Now I know exactly where we are.
Where?
Amy asked, her eyes shining with excitement. King is taking us to the George Mason University at Manassas. They have a biomedical research lab off campus where research is performed on, among others, Burkholderia and equine encephalitis viruses. Amy frowned.
English, please? How far are we from home?
About 70 miles, Tara said.
70 miles? Amy exclaimed with a look of horror. 70 miles through strange, zombie-infested territory in the dead of winter?
I'm afraid so.
Amy began to dig around in the supplies around them. Then we'd better grab what we can before we escape. Food, clothes, blankets. It's a pity we don't have any weapons, but I guess we'll...
Amy, Tara said, hating to squash the girl's youthful enthusiasm.
Have to make do. We can always find something along the way, Amy continued.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.